Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tarot Deciphered, Decoding Esoteric Symbolism in Modern Tarot, by T. Susan Chang and M. M. Meleen, narrated by Leslie Howard. Publisher's note, this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Tarot Deciphered into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code CARD and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. Images of tarot cards, hexagrams, tables, figures, and geomantic figures referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Foreword. For nearly 50 years, tarot has played the role of conflicted protagonist in the dark comedy mystery drama that is my spiritual life. Unlike many tarot enthusiasts, I never, even in my adolescent daydreams, fantasized about becoming a professional fortune teller or spiritual counselor to rock stars and celebrities. I never yearned for the mysterious power to foresee the future, especially my own. Nor ever did I seriously entertain the possibility that there was some vaporous supernatural intelligence, good or evil, behind the oracular voice of tarot. I wish I could say that my tarot agnosticism sprang from my consummate intellect and mature power of discernment, but alas, I possess neither. Now, the simple fact is I'm lazy. I'm too lazy to dream of any personal power, much beyond the ability to arrange comfortable shelter, nutritious food, and the chance to develop the nuances of the odd character I'm meant to portray in this life. I lack the ambition necessary to barter with destiny or attempt to strategically scheme to cheat fortune. It's not that I don't hunger for new knowledge and insights and experiences. It's not that I don't constantly seek out new ways to trigger my own awakening to greater realities. It's not that I don't long to know why I exist and what it is I'm here to do. Indeed, it is precisely those few intangible ambitions that trump the professional and domestic goals that consume the thoughts and hours and lives of most others of my class, culture, and species. At first, all I was looking for in tarot was a flashcard memory aid for studying and organizing the fundamentals of Hermetic Qabalah as an adjunct to my initiatory work as a ceremonial magician. Little did I know at the time that tarot would eventually become for me nothing less than the foundation, the framework, the walls, the flying buttresses, even the ornamentation of the temple of my entire evolving magical universe. Like the authors of this marvelous guide to esoteric tarot, I eventually created my own tarot deck. I think it is safe to say that neither they nor I embarked upon this life-changing odyssey in order to make a lot of money. Only the childishly naive believe one can strike it rich creating esoteric products. Indeed, I never expected my tarot to be marketed at all. For me, these 78 pieces of painted cardstock were the only way I could begin to wrap my meat brain around the complexity of all the moving parts that make up the Kabbalistic language of ceremonial magic. A spiritual art form to which, in spite of my inherent laziness, I am inexplicably drawn. Ceremonial magic, at least as it has been developed in the last 200 years, is not a singular study. Furthermore, it is a frustrating fact of life that there doesn't seem to be a front door to the temple or university of magic. Every magician I've ever known has confessed that when they started their magical education, it felt like breaking into a school building through some unguarded window and then eavesdropping on an incomprehensible masterclass already in progress. It's true. In order to even approach magic's potential as a self-transformational process, the neophyte must already be armed with a rich vocabulary of a score of diverse subjects, ranging from astrology and alchemy to Hebrew Qabalah, Eastern mysticism, and mythology. Organized orders and magical societies provide the semblance of structure and order to the educational process. And for many of us, these organizations were helpful and gave us a glimpse of the bigger picture of the great edifice of magic. Furthermore, 21st century magicians are especially lucky to have the occult wisdom of the ages available to us at our electronic fingertips. This awesome library, coupled with the in-temple dramatic experiences of being involved in an initiatory order, gives the individual a decided advantage over our ancient colleagues. One of the wisest educational assignments of the great 19th century mystery school, the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn, was that the new initiate was required to create their own tarot deck, generically patterned on an archetypal mother deck. By taking the time and effort to paint each card, the new magician was, in effect, reprogramming their magical software, bringing it into closer approximation to the universal harmonies the cards exemplify. The hours and days and weeks and months the individual spent focusing on every unique symbolic detail of the cards became more than just an exercise in rote memorization. It was a mutation process, a tinkering with one's spiritual DNA, a full upgrade of the operating system of the soul, a magical vaccine injected directly into the quantum dimension of the psyche via the awesome delivery system of art. And like art and vaccines, the experience triggers a transformational response that is unique to every organism. Making your own tarot deck requires you to give yourself a first-class liberal arts education in occultism, but it also does so much more. Almost by accident, you simultaneously absorb the fundamental principles of the Hebrew Qabalah, the alphabet, the numerical and mathematical characteristics. You see laid out before you the seamless associations of elements, planetary spheres, signs of the zodiac, astrological rulerships, exaltations, decan and decree assignments, vibratory color scales, and classic mythological archetypes. Without even realizing what's happening, the novice almost subconsciously metamorphosizes into a well-lubricated adept, a magician. Perhaps you think I'm exaggerating. Perhaps I am. Even after 50 years of playing various instruments in the Tarot Symphony Orchestra, the only thing I can say with complete honesty is it's too soon to tell. But I am smugly comfortable with the place tarot holds in my magical life, and I'm quite happy to share my experiences and temporary conclusions about the importance of this marvelous and magical art. But unlike M.M. Meleen, I'm not much of an artist. My own tarot deck, while displaying many occult, astrological, and magical correspondences on the cards themselves, is definitely not an artistic tour de force. As a matter of fact, my laziness has allowed me to be shamelessly satisfied with simple line drawings I hurriedly created as best I could. My wife, Constance, then colored them in with watercolors, according to the strict Kabbalistic color scales associated with each of the cards. M.M. Meleen, however, is a real, profoundly skilled, and awesomely talented artist. And her genius renders her eminently qualified to comment authoritatively on the work of other great tarot artists of the past. The transcendent power displayed in her consummately executed works is a testament to the art of magic as a consciousness-elevating tool and talisman. When art at this level is coupled with the archetypal images and Kabbalistic structure of the tarot, we are blessed with an alchemical marriage whose progeny are miniature monuments of perfection and beauty. I hope I haven't embarrassed the authors with my praise of this work and the talents of its creators. As you will hear the wonders of the tarot's perfect construction, there is more than enough information here for you to embark upon your own tarot odyssey. The book has been organized so as to painlessly reveal the method to the madness. This picture book of tarot is exactly what I was looking for 50 years ago, but more importantly, it comes dangerously close to showing me why I was looking for it. Lon Milo Duquette. Introduction. Every one of us at the beginning of our tarot journey has looked at a tarot card and wondered, what could that symbol possibly mean? At one level, the answer to that question doesn't matter. You may well be able to read the cards intuitively, even fluently, without having to articulate a definition for the symbol. Nevertheless, for so many of us, a small mercurial voice in your minds still wants to know. Is that an Aquarius sign scratched there in the corner? What are those Hebrew letters inscribed in that square doing there? Why is that snake biting its tail? You feel sure there is an answer, but the card is mute. Happily, if you've been in a similar situation, you are not alone. In this book, you will find answers to these questions and many more. Why Esoteric Tarot? Esoteric Tarot is more than just a symbol-by-symbol analysis. It is an analysis and synthesis that distills and refines the meaning of each card. It provides a structure for the intellect to rest upon, and from the refuge of that space, the mind can rest and recall what is useful as feelings and intuitions arise in the oracular moment. The many myths and symbols tell stories that reflect the infinitely elastic meanings of each card and the multitudes we all contain. In the main body of the text, we use the examples of the Rider-Waite-Smith and Thoth decks because most are familiar with them. But these esoteric schemas are keys that can unlock any modern deck that descends from them. Both decks share a common root, for their creators were both adepts of the same influential Western occult order that developed much of the esoteric framework tarot is mapped to. Looking at and learning only one of these two pivotal deck systems is like only being able to see an object in one view, while learning the roots they share is like seeing them from the front, back, and in profile, as well as from above and below. We show how these keys apply to a wide variety of decks in the other deck illustrations we show in caption. Astrology and Esoteric Tarot. We use the astrological tarot correspondences of the Hermetic Golden Dawn. The iconic Rider-Waite-Smith and Thoth tarots are both built on this framework. Knowingly or not, most modern decks are too, when they derive from the framework these sources made popular. Some may be puzzled by a few of their choices at first, but the longer we have worked with the Golden Dawn correspondence system, the more evident its internal eloquence. In order to make this guide as useful as possible to as many as possible, we focused on those astrological concepts most closely related to esoteric tarot, the elements, the seven classical planets, the 12 signs, and the 36 decans, their constellations and mythology. Needless to say, galaxies of further correspondences and vast realms of further inquiry exist, and we hope you will take every opportunity to explore them further on your own. Internal variations of the Thoth deck. There are, of course, a few differences between Waite's Rider-Waite-Smith deck and Crowley's Thoth deck. While both began with the basic Golden Dawn system of references, Crowley, through discoveries made during his own work as an adept, made a few changes, which we make note of in the text. In modern decks, when you see pages referred to as princesses, or judgment referred to as eon, or strength entitled lust, and numbered 11 rather than 8, these are usually good indications that the creator is working within Crowley's framework. Qabalah and Esoteric Tarot. The Tree of Life, a conceptual diagram depicting the unfolding of creation through 10 spheres, or sephirot, has its roots deep in Jewish mysticism. Its branches have extended across the study of traditional Qabalah for over 1,000 years. One of those branches profoundly influenced the intellectual and magical movement known as Hermeticism, which co-opted the tradition for its own purposes and began to diverge markedly from its precursors with the work of Athanasius Kircher in the 17th century. By the early 20th century, Hermetic Qabalah, the Q widely used to distinguish it from Christian Qabalah, which uses a C, and Jewish Qabalah, which begins with a K, has developed its own set of conventions, beliefs, and even its own version of the tree. This version would become a foundational concept across schools of Western occultism, thanks to its core presence in the Golden Dawn's efforts to organize many heterogeneous mystical cosmologies into a single system. It is Hermetic Qabalah that informs the Golden Dawn's mapping of the Tree of Life to tarot. And therefore, when we refer to sephirot, paths, and Hebrew letter attributions in this book, we are referring to them in a Hermetic Qabalah context. That said, there are times when ideas borrowed by the Golden Dawn or others from traditional Qabalah chime and resonate with their distant Hermetic descendants. We include some of these in a spirit of respect and exploration, and we use the phrase traditional Qabalah to set them apart from the overall Qabalistic framework of this book. Our spelling choices are those used widely in modern-day Hermetic Qabalah. Teferet, spelled T-I-P-H-A-R-E-T-H rather than T-I-F-E-R-E-T. Sephira, spelled S-E-P-H-I-R-A rather than S-E-F-I-R-A. We recognize that some may view these as a Victorian corruption of Hebrew transliteration as currently practiced, but by observing Hermetic conventions, our intent is to honor the integrity of and the boundaries between the separate traditions. Mythology and Esoteric Tarot. In the mythology section, an eclectic variety of myths are referenced. They include classical Greek and Roman mythologies, Orphic variations, Egyptian myths across many dynasties, Mesopotamian epics, deities of Buddhism and Hinduism, and even a few more modern tales. The criteria for including a story was that it somehow referenced mythological beings with as many of the planetary, zodiacal, and Kabbalistic correspondence resonances as possible, while also being evocative of the themes expressed in the card. Many were chosen intuitively, based on a feeling similar to the oracular moment. We hope these suggestions offer a starting place for your mythological excavations. The Rider-Waite-Smith Tarot. The Rider-Waite-Smith, or Waite-Smith deck, is the iconic deck of modern tarot. While not immediately influential on its release in 1910, it blossomed into popular consciousness with its 1971 reissue, and has been a global touchstone for tarot ever since. It has provided inspiration for countless modern decks, and a majority of new readers rely on its accessible images, particularly the scenic minors, for their first entry into tarot. The original source text for Waite-Smith is Arthur Edward Waite's Pictorial Key to the Tarot. Unless otherwise noted, all quotations from Waite in the Rider-Waite-Smith sections of the book come from Pictorial Key. Although Waite was a member of the Golden Dawn and well-versed in its esoteric Book T interpretations of the cards, he was also clearly drawn to the iconography of what was already a 500-year-old tarot idiom. In the deck, we can see influences from 15th and 16th century works like the Sola Busca Taroki and the Tarot de Marseille, and many of Waite's pictorial key meanings derive directly from the work of Etea, the 18th century French occultist. As the artist Pamela Coleman Smith was famously free to interpret Waite's prompts with as much artistic license as she saw fit, for the minor arcana, Waite's prompts were quite scant to begin with. But she too was a habitué and an initiate of the Golden Dawn Circle, and she applied her peculiar genius to the cards in her own way. She did not seem to refer to Waite's esoterics nearly as closely as Lady Frieda Harris later would to Crowley's in the Thoth deck. So when we speak of astrological myths or Qabalistic symbolism implied in the Waite-Smith images, we are speaking speculatively. We don't attribute any intent on Smith's part to the connections we draw. We are reading into the images, not from them, as readers have done since cardomancy began. The Thoth Tarot. The Book of Thoth is the main source text for Crowley's thoughts on the Thoth cards, unless otherwise noted. We sometimes reference other technical libers of his, either because he has specifically mentioned them in his chapter on the card in body or footnote, or because they obviously or wonderfully relate to the card image or message. The Thoth deck is a masterpiece. Aleister Crowley and Lady Frieda Harris were both mature individuals in their 60s at the time of the deck's creation. Crowley put the entirety of his considerable knowledge, earned over his lifetime of attainments as a spiritual adept, into the symbolism of each card. Each and every card can convey a wealth of profound conceptual esoteric teachings, far more than can be covered in the scope of this book. Yet the Thoth deck owes its evocative beauty to the artist, Lady Frieda Harris. It was Lady Harris who first suggested to Crowley the idea of redesigning the traditional tarot and writing about it, something he at first was highly resistant to. Harris was a co-mason and student of esotericism and theosophy, but she knew little of ceremonial magic. She offered to pay Crowley a weekly stipend and to paint the cards as book illustrations if he would teach her magic as part of the process and write a comprehensive tarot text. A process that was supposed to take months took 5 years, and the rest is history. For together, they created an enduring magnum opus that continues to broaden minds to this day. What makes the art of the Thoth deck so compelling is Lady Harris's distinctive Art Deco style and her ingenious use of projective geometry, which she learned as a student of the disciples of Rudolf Steiner. What made the deck even more esoterically expressive was the incorporation of the color scale system of the Golden Dawn. This system of mapping specific colors to the four Kabbalistic worlds of the Tree of Life allowed each card to be an invocation of the essence of the specific path or sephira through the evocative use of color. The Ordo Templi Orientis, OTO, owns the image rights to the Thoth Tarot. Unfortunately, the OTO currently allows publication of the images only in works exclusively dedicated to discussion of the Thoth Tarot, without comparative discourse of other decks. While we think that such correlative discussion would only favorably highlight the majesty of Crowley and Harris's brilliant creation, we thus had to forego including these masterful artworks in hope that listeners will seek them out in a physical deck or the many widely available online images. It will certainly prove worthwhile to study the images along with our text. Correspondences found and not found in this book. A vast infrastructure of correspondences undergirds the Golden Dawn-based tarot decks we study. In this guide, we choose to focus on correspondences which listeners will be able to see fairly easily in any modern deck. Besides the Rider-Waite-Smith and Thoth decks, we've included images drawn from Mel's decks and several other Llewellyn and Lo Scarabeo decks. As a result, you won't be able to look up Yazgedi Barodiel, Angel of the Cadent Decanate of Capricorn, in here. You'll need Aleister Crowley's exhaustive 777 for that. Indeed, if you're listening to this book, you probably have a copy on your shelf already. You can also use Susie's Tarot Correspondences, a general reference for the major historical and magical correspondences relevant to tarot and how to use them. If you have those texts, a few decks, Rider-Waite-Smith, Thoth, and an M.M. Meleen deck, and this card-by-card guide, your foray into esoteric tarot is well underway. Major Arcana. About the Golden Dawn titles. The Golden Dawn assigned formal or hermetic titles to the 22 major arcana. These grand and often poetic epithets generally allude to one or more esoteric qualities associated with each card. For example, the High Priestess's hermetic title is the Priestess of the Silver Star. The Silver Star might be the Moon, her astrological correspondence. The Empress is the Daughter of the Mighty Ones. The Mighty Ones may refer to the supernal Sephirot, Keter, Chokmah, and Bina, and her path on the Tree of Life forms the base of the triangle they form. By using these titles to capture esoteric qualities inherent in each archetype, the Golden Dawn joins a tradition of prayer and invocation extending back to the earliest hymns. By uttering the name of the deity and its powers, a supplicant invests her words with additional meaning and ensures her prayers will be heard. The 22 major arcana cards can be astrologically divided via esoteric assignment into groups of 3, 7, and 12. The three primary or classical elements that make up all of nature, air, water, and fire, correspond to the cards of the Fool, Hanged Man, and Judgment or Aeon, respectively. But what about the element of earth? As the earth element is comprised of a combination of all of the elements in equilibrium, it has been assigned to the World or Universe card, which also is the summation of all that has come before it. Thus, the World or Universe card does what we call double duty, for it is also assigned the planetary correspondence of Saturn, who not only rules one of the earth signs, but whose heavy qualities are also resonant with the cold weight of earth. Similarly, the Judgment or Aeon card also does double duty, for in addition to corresponding to the fire element, it is also assigned the mysterious animating fifth element of spirit, known as ether, or sometimes as void. Each element has three signs, one of each quadruplicity. The initiator is cardinal, the middle sign listed is fixed, and the last mutable. The fire signs are Aries, cardinal, Leo, fixed, and Sagittarius, mutable. The water signs are Cancer, Scorpio, and Pisces. The air signs are Libra, Aquarius, and Gemini. The seven planets of classical astrology, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, and our two luminaries, the Sun and Moon, are assigned to the Magician, Empress, Tower, Fortune, World, Sun, and Priestess, respectively. Planets are said to rule the signs of their domicile, a place where they are given what is termed dignity, or the freedom of expression that comes with familiar territory. Each planet rules two signs, a diurnal or day sign, and a nocturnal or night sign, while the sun and moon each rule a single sign. The more recently discovered planets, Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto, have also been assigned in modern astrology as dual rulers of the signs Aquarius, Pisces, and Scorpio, respectively. The diagram in the bonus material shows the elegance of the assignment by placing the luminaries and their signs at the top of an astrological wheel. The signs proceed in order around the circumference, with the planets in orbital order along each side, and day and night sign rulerships alternating. It also shows the concepts of how aspects are derived. Each sign has 30 degrees of the circular, complete zodiacal band. The opposition shows signs 180 degrees, or six signs apart, dividing the circle in half. These are said to be on the same axis, that is, Leo and Aquarius. The trine shows signs 120 degrees, or four signs apart, dividing the circle into a triangle. The square divides the circle fourfold, with signs 90 degrees, or three signs apart. The sextile shows signs 60 degrees, or two signs apart, dividing the circle six ways. Adjacent signs, or those 30 degrees apart, are in semi-sextile aspect. In general, oppositions are polarizing and squares are frictional, but both yield potential growth opportunities. Trines are harmonious but not stimulating, and sextiles and semi-sextiles show possibilities to explore that may yield positive results if effort is applied. The astrological signs divide the zodiac into 12 30-degree segments. Though entire books can be written about the nuances of each sign, each has a short declarative motto that attempts to summarize their nature as concisely as possible. Astrological qualities or quadruplicities. The 12 zodiacal signs can be divided into three modalities or qualities, each into groups of four, one for each element. Cardinal signs begin the seasons, such as 0 degrees Aries being the start of spring in the northern hemisphere. The cardinal signs, Aries, Cancer, Libra, and Capricorn, are active and controlling, tending to initiate. The fixed signs, Leo, Scorpio, Aquarius, and Taurus, are when the season is fully established and are thus steady, tending to maintain. The mutable signs, Sagittarius, Pisces, Gemini, and Virgo, end the season, and so are flexible, tending toward change. Signs that share a quality or quadruplicity are either in opposition or square to each other. For example, the cardinal sign Aries is on the same axis, or in opposition to, the cardinal sign Libra, while squaring the other two cardinal signs, Cancer and Capricorn, who also share an axis. What does all of this astrology have to do with tarot? While it is by no means necessary to memorize these correspondences and relationships, knowing how elements, signs, and planets interact can add additional depth to your readings by seeing how the related cards may influence and relate to each other when they appear in the same spread. Qabalah of the Majors. The Tree of Life is a configuration of 10 spheres, or sephirot, and is the foundation of Kabbalistic, spelled with K or Q, thought. 22 paths, each assigned to one letter of the Hebrew alphabet, join the 10 sephirot. The 22 major arcana map to these paths with the same 3-7-12 structure we see in the astrology of the major arcana: 3 mother letters, 7 double letters, and 12 simple letters. Aleph, Mem, Sheen. The 3 mother letters are Aleph, Mem, and Sheen, correlating to the elements of air, water, and fire. From these, according to mystical thought, everything in the cosmos arises, including the 4th element, earth. Bet, Gimel, Dalet, Kaf, Pe, Resh, Tav. The 7 double letters are Bet, Gimel, Dalet, Kaf, Pe, Resh, and Tav, and correlate to the 7 traditional planets: Mercury, the Moon, Venus, Jupiter, Mars, the Sun, and Saturn. Like the wandering planets themselves, which draw nearer to and farther from us at different points, these letters vary in their sound, one hard pronunciation and one soft pronunciation. Their metaphysical significations come in pairs of opposites, for example, wisdom and folly. He, Vav, Zayin, Het, Tet, Yod, Lamed, Nun, Samech, Ayin, Zadi, and Kof. The 12 simple letters are He, Vav, Zayin, Het, Tet, Yod, Lamed, Nun, Samech, Ayin, Zadi, and Kof. They correlate to the 12 zodiacal signs in order from Aries to Pisces. These letters do not vary in their pronunciation, just as the constellations do not vary in their distance from the Earth. Metaphysically, they relate to single human attributes, such as mirth or anger. We use a number of concepts from the Tree of Life to talk about the major arcana. The supernals, or supernal triad, are the 3 sephirot at the top of the tree: Keter, Chokmah, and Bina. These are considered divine, beyond human comprehension, and abyss, Da'at, separates them from the other 7. The 3 vertical uprights one can draw through the Tree of Life are the 3 pillars: the Pillar of Mercy, or Pillar of Force, on the right, and the Pillar of Severity, or Pillar of Form, on the left. The central line is the middle pillar, or middle path. The lightning flash is the zigzag that descends from Keter to Malkut, touching each of the 10 sephirot in turn. This represents the ongoing act of creation. The 4 worlds are 4 stages of manifestation descending down the Tree of Life: the archetypal world, Atzilut; the world of creation, Bria; the world of formation, Yetzirah; and the world of action, Asiya. There are a number of ways to visualize this. One we use often assigns the 3 upper supernal sephirot to Atzilut, the next 3 sephirot to Bria, the lower 3 sephirot to Yetzirah, and the last sephira, Malkut, to Asiya. The Fool, the Spirit of the Ether, card number 0, element air, Hebrew letter Aleph, Hebrew letter meaning mother letter, ox, value 1, path 11, Keter, 1, crown or prima mobile, to Chokmah, 2, wisdom or zodiac. Color scales in the 4 worlds: bright pale yellow, sky blue, blue emerald green, emerald flecked gold. Themes and keywords: all and nothing, zero, beginnings, emanation, deity, creation, fertility, air, breath, silence, nascence, folly and madness versus holy wisdom, innocence, ignorance, going forth. Astrology and element. The Fool corresponds to the element air, the suit of the mind and reason. Air contains the elements fire and water, yet the Fool's esoteric title is the Spirit of Ether. Ether is somewhat akin to air. The theoretical substance ether, spelled A-E-T-H-E-R or E-T-H-E-R, was once believed to be a universal elastic medium for the transmission of electromagnetic waveforms. Distributed throughout all matter and permeating all space, it was only assumed to be there as it was invisible, weightless, frictionless, and undetectable. Transmitting light and heat, it was also referred to as luminiferous ether. Aristotle believed that ether extended from the fixed stars down to the moon. The ancient Greeks used the term to refer to the upper air, the region of space beyond the atmosphere, the blue heavens, and the clear upper air personified. It's also a term for a highly volatile, flammable liquid anesthetic. In metaphysics, the term also sometimes refers to spirit, or the fifth element, and the void, or vacuum. In Enochian tradition, it is the succession of worlds within, surrounding, and extending beyond the material world. All this agrees with the Fool's association with Kether, the sephira of the primum mobile, the outermost moving sphere in the geocentric model of the universe, and with the three veils surrounding the Kabbalistic tree of life. Modern astrologers usually assign Uranus, or sometimes Pluto, to the Fool. Because of its association with zero, the Fool also has a resonance with the Aries point, the point at 0 degrees of Aries in the zodiac, where the zodiac and the season of spring begins. Mythology and alchemy. Both innocent and virile, the Fool is associated with Dionysus or Bacchus, the god of wine and revelry, of fertility, religious ecstasy, and ritual madness. Dionysus is said to be a god of epiphany, and epiphany, or revelation, refers to inspiration received from divinity. His appearance is said to induce a frenzy in his followers akin to divine madness, freeing them from self-conscious cares, fears, and oppressions. His iconography includes pine cones, grapes, figs, ivy, tigers, leopards, and serpents. Depictions of Dionysus either show him as a mature, bearded man, a sensuous and attractive beardless youth, a ridiculously garbed or partially nude androgynous youth, or an effeminate male. Crowley's 777 lists the correct design of the tarot fool as a bearded ancient seen in profile. And though we see him as a bearded jester in some Marseille decks, modern decks portray him as either a harlequin, an androgynous youth, or as a sort of green man of the spring festival. The Orphic First Dionysus, Zagros the Horned, was an underworld god dismembered by the Titans and reborn, paralleling the story of the Egyptian Osiris. The Fool is also associated with Zeus Uranothelus, the primordial lord of air who embodies the concept that the original god, Tetragrammaton, was both male and female. Though sources list Dionysus as being born after being sewn into Zeus's thigh or testicles, the Oracle of Apollo declared Zeus, Hades, and Dionysus three gods in one godhead, overseeing birth, death, and reincarnation. The Fool has resonance with Parsifal, the Fisher King, and the Grail Quest. Tales of wandering princes who marry the king's daughter and become king are applicable to the Fool's story. As the absence of speech and the indrawn breath, the Fool also has associations with Harpocrates, god of silence. Qabalah, Path 11. The Fool represents the letter Aleph, one of the three mother letters of the Hebrew alphabet. Aleph corresponds to the element of air, mem to water, and shin to fire. Aleph means ox or bull. Both, like Pan or Bacchus figures, are ancient symbols of fertility and generative power, apt beginnings for the story of creation. Aleph's shape depicts a point unfolding in four directions and set in motion, the whirling swastika, once revered as a solar symbol before being co-opted in the modern age for darker purposes. Airy Aleph also corresponds to the chest, where people take air into their lungs as their first act as living beings. This is the same indrawn breath taken before speech, one, the magician or magus. In this silence is contained everything that follows, the beginning and end of all the universe. The tree of life, or all creation, emanates from three veils of nothingness, known as Ain, nothingness, or nothing that is not, Ein Sof, infinity or nothing without limit, and Ein Sof Or, limitless light. From these veils then contracts the first sephira, Keter, a dimensionless point of light or crown. The fool's path on the tree of life runs from Keter to the second sephira, Chokmah, wisdom, from the middle pillar to the pillar of force. As the first path on the tree, it represents Kabbalistic zero, the negative space from which all else emanates. In Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Tetragrammaton, letter Yod is said to reside in Chokmah, with its tip in Keter. Rider-Waite-Smith symbolism. This iconic image of the fool holds a number of hidden references to the Tree of Life. The white sun at the upper right refers to Keter, the first sephira. Its 14 rays may refer to 1, Keter, plus 2, Chokmah, plus 11, path number. The line in the image passes from the sun to the lower left, reflecting the fool's path from an inside-the-tree perspective. He could be about to step into the abyss of Da'at, the void below the supernal Sephirot. Or he might be stepping all the way down to Malkut, which is symbolized by his white rose. The rose, whose scent he may have just sniffed, is white, as is his shirt and his dog, all conveying purity of intent. 10 8-spoked wheels adorn his tunic. There are 10 wheels for the 10 sephirot, and 8 spokes for the wheel of spirit, the compass rose, and the eightfold model of consciousness. His cliff-top attitude, the yellow color of the background, his carefree mien, and the feather in his cap all point to the element of air. The feather's red color symbolizes the life force. We'll see it again in the Death and Sun cards. The fool's elaborate tunic alludes to both the raiment of court jesters and the rags and tatters of the itinerant madman pictured in earlier versions of the fool. Finally, his little dog is another holdover from early tarot, though its role, to attack, as in older versions, to warn, or merely to gamble about, is ambiguous. Thoth symbolism. The Thoth fool breaks the mold. An intense, horned and virile man in green and gold, bursting onto the scene with nothing but air beneath his feet. He's about to be borne headfirst through 3 loops that appear as the wake of a winged caduceus flying toward his heart. These ovals may represent the 3 negative veils of existence that the fool must pass through before entering the path of creation. These circular forms also represent zero and nui, fertilized by the winged disc within, conceiving Hurpakrat, also known as Harpocrates, the god of silence. The card is teeming with symbols representing the beginnings of everything from nothing. The butterfly of air, symbol of the soul entering incarnation, follows in the track behind the winged disc, Hadit, with the caduceus a forerunner of the fool's evolution to Magus. A dove descends, for spirit's descent into matter, and the vulture, Maut, rides the spiral. The fool holds a flaming pine cone, the thyrsus of Dionysus, and crystal cup of water. Combining them creates air and then the tree of life. On his head is a diamond of white light, Keter, with the sun, Tiferet, at the center over his procreative organ, and the crocodile Sebek at his feet standing in for Malkut, the moon to his son. The crocodile is also associated with Hurpakrat. He bears Dionysian grapes in a transparent sack holding blue coins marked with the entire universe, sun surrounded by 6 planets, encircled by the zodiacal signs. Biting his thigh is a tiger, another Dionysian distraction of lust and passion. Between his legs is a rose, the white of Keter and the rose of Malkut, with dangling lilies. Crowley calls them the benediction of 3 flowers in one, referring to the final Heh, the daughter of the Tetragrammaton, who contains all the qualities of the father, mother, and son who precede her. Beneath them, the twinned infants, Vav and final He, embrace, destined to grow into the solar twins, active Rahurkut and passive Hurpakrat. The background colored the yellow of air is speckled with diamonds in the white brilliance of Keter. Related cards. In a sense, you could say that all cards are contained in the Fool, as he is the as-yet-unrealized potential of all that will follow. But he is also the representative of elemental air, in the same way that the Hanged Man stands for elemental water, and Judgment or Aeon for elemental fire. As elemental air, he has a specific connection to the three major arcana of air, Justice and Adjustment, Libra, the Star, Aquarius, and the Lovers, Gemini. Although he begins his journey as a blank slate, he will in time learn to weigh his options, navigate toward goals, and make informed choices. His story is a wayfinding from folly to wisdom, from ignorance to knowledge. Indeed, his mirror image on the tree, the magician, is defined by knowledgeability. The intellectual, airy suit of swords also reflects this perilous voyage of free will. When the Fool grasps the Ace of Swords for the first time, he becomes literally willful. He has an intention and the will to carry it out. In the 2, 3, and 4 of Swords, peace, sorrow, and truce, he will encounter his first crossroads, his first crisis, and his first compromise. In the 5, 6, and 7, defeat, science, and futility, he will counter risk with goal setting and schemes of varying success. Finally, in the 8, 9, and 10, interference, cruelty, and ruin, he faces a paralyzing choice, kills off some options, and thus commits to an outcome. For better or worse, it is the collapse of a quantum state into a certainty. Advanced concepts for further exploration. Eheya, a god name transliterated from the Hebrew, translated as I will be. The relationship between the Fool as first and the universe as last major arcana. The descent of spirit, Keter, into matter, Malkut, as the lightning flash of emanation connecting all the sephirot of the tree of life. The balancing and cleansing path of the flaming sword, another descending process from unity to multiplicity, where the first swirlings of creation bring all possible energies into balance within the manifest world of everyday experience. The corresponding ascent of matter, Malkut, toward deity, Keter, through the path of the serpent, a redemptive rising of consciousness via a complex connective weaving and balancing of the paths, major arcana, of the tree of life. The fifth and unifying power of the four elemental powers of the Sphinx, the power of spirit, ire, to go, a function of Godhead. Magical weapon, the dagger or fan. Magical power, divination. The magician or magus, the magus of power. Card number 1, planet and dignities. Mercury, rules Gemini and Virgo, exalted Virgo, day of the week, Wednesday. Hebrew letter, bet. Hebrew letter meaning, double letter, house, life, and death. Value 2. Path 12, Keter, 1, crown or prima mobile, 2, Bina, 3, understanding or Saturn. Color scales in the four worlds. Yellow, purple, gray, indigo, rayed violet. Themes and keywords. Will, magic. As above, so below. Words and thoughts with power to bend reality. Words as trickery. Illusion versus change in accordance with will. Knowledge, skills, tools, connection, transmission, universal access to all realms. Mind, with all its virtues and flaws, the wand. Astrology or element. Speedy, tiny Mercury, the closest planet to the sun, has an orbit of only 88 days. It has no moons and flies solo. Because of its proximity to the sun, it rises and sets with it, so it is difficult to see in our night sky. Because its orbit lies inside that of Earth's, it has phases, but we can never see its full phase as it is always behind or in front of the sun. It's never more than 28 degrees from the degree of the sun, being either in the same sign or an adjacent one. The sun governs force, spirit, the positive, masculine polarity, while the moon rules form, body, the negative, feminine polarity. But Mercury is androgynous, being the mind or messenger between the two. It's one of the most important influences on a chart because it tells much about the mind, which creates reality, and describes the intellect and style of communication. It rules messages transmitted and received, travel, motion, magic, the sciences, and logic. Mercury's glyph combines the circle of spirit above the cross of matter and is topped by the crescent of personality, which looks remarkably like a figure wearing a winged cap or transmitting antenna. Mercury has dual rulership over mutable air sign Gemini as its day sign and mutable earth sign Virgo as its night sign. As Gemini, it expresses its quicksilver nature, curiosity, versatility, and wit. As Virgo, it expresses common sense, attention to detail, deep analysis, and logical thought. Mythology and alchemy. Mercurial gods all bear the creative and compelling power of the logos, the will and word. Hermes, Mercurius, was known as he of the persuasive tongue. He wears the talaria, winged sandals that give swiftness, and either the pedasus, traveler's cap, or winged helmet, and he carries the herald staff, or caduceus. He is the messenger of the gods, a mischievous trickster, the patron of travelers. Hermes is a friend of those who pursue the occult arts, merchants, thieves, orators, and those in the fields of art and science. In his thonic form, he takes on the role of psychopomp. Hermes Trismegistus, thrice great, is a form of Hermes combined with the Egyptian god Thoth. Thoth ruled Hermopolis over the Ogdoad, eightfold, a pantheon of eight primordial gods. He was the measurer of time and the scribe of the gods, and he was credited with the inventions of all branches of knowledge, human and divine, astronomy, writing, science, law, mathematics, medicine, and the measurements that establish the heavens and earth. As a scribe, he appears with the head of an ibis. In the underworld, he appears as an ape. His feminine counterpart was Sushet, she who scrivens, mistress of the house of books, overseer of the royal scribes and library, and duly credited with all of Thoth's inventions. Prometheus, who stole fire from heaven and gifted it to man, is also a mercurial figure. Other figures cognate are Loki, Ganesha, and Hanuman. It's usually the magician as the Mercury card, where one thinks to find alchemical Mercury. In alchemy, Mercury represents the spirit, mind. Sulfur represents the soul, consciousness, life. And salt represents the body, matter. Because alchemical Mercury is spirit and mind, both the fool and the magician share this role, just as one evolves from the other. Qabalah, Path 12. The magus, or magician, corresponds to the Hebrew letter bet, meaning house. It is the first of seven double letters, each of which will correspond to one of the seven classical planets: bet, Mercury; gimel, moon; dalet, Venus; Kaf, Jupiter; Pe, Mars; Resh, Sun; Tav, Saturn. The glyph of Mercury touches every sephira on the tree except for Keter. As keeper of the house, the magus creates worlds within worlds and forges connections between above and below, microcosm and macrocosm. Each double letter marries two opposing powers, in this case, life and death, pointing to his role as interpreter, psychopomp, and traveler between realms. This polarity repeats in the colors of the two sephirot connected by his path, Keter, white, and Bina, black. His path travels from Keter to Bina, a mirror image to that of the fool, extending to the pillar of form instead of the pillar of force. If the fool is the intake of breath, the magician is the outflow, the utterance of the spoken word. Bina, first Sephira on the pillar of form, signals an impulse to enclose and make formed. As the intermediary between Kether and Bina, the magician turns the ideal into the real. His powers of manifestation draw attention to a core hermetic principle. That which is above resembles that which is below. Because Mercury corresponds to the eighth Sephira, Hod, we also see references to the number 8 in both versions. Rider-Waite-Smith symbolism. The Waite-Smith magician, known to all from the yellow box of the classic 1971 Rider Tarot, appears here a Western ceremonial magician. Waite says he has the countenance of divine Apollo, with a smile of confidence and shining eyes. His continental predecessors were tricksters and conmen, Il Bagatto, Le Jongleur, etc. But now a table once full of hustlers' trinkets holds four familiar mystical emblems: a wand, a cup, a sword, and a pentacle. The magic at work here is no illusion, but an act that changes reality. The magician points up to Kether and down to Bina. As above, so below is the Hermetic magician's creed, from the emerald tablet of Hermes Trismegistus. Divination and magic depend on this correspondence between the invisible and the mundane. Other binaries are at work. The stark black and white of the magician's features and robe suggests the sephirot defining his path, Kether, white, crown as headband, and Bina, black. As illustrated throughout the deck, wherever roses and lilies appear, red stands for passion, carnality, and the number 5. White stands for spirit, purity of intention, and the number 6. Above his head is the analemma of the sun's orbit, a reference to Mercury's close relationship with the sun. It is also a symbol of infinity, or the magician's power to manifest everything and anything the heart desires. It is also a figure 8, a reference to the Sephira Hod and the number of Mercury. Finally, the Ouroboros, or serpent at his waist, alludes to the twining snakes of Hermes's caduceus, to secret knowledge, and to the unending cycle of life and death. Thoth symbolism. In the Thoth card, the magus doesn't hold the wand. He is the wand, the channel of will. His body is the yellow of his color in the Golden Dawn King scale, connecting him with both the fool and the sun. He is accompanied by the gray cynocephalous ape, who shadows Thoth to mock and deceive. His gesture is similar to that of the RWS magician, for similar reasons outlined. His posture also forms the glyph of Mercury, whose tracing encompasses all of the sephirot of the Tree of Life except Kether. The top of the wand has the caduceus with winged disc, a symbol for both the phallus and for Hadid. The circular center contains a descending dove, an extension of spirit, Kether, into form, Bina, and symbolic of the feminine principle within the masculine, since Mercury is an androgynous figure. The wings of the figure appear to extend into pleated shapes reminiscent of the fan, a magical weapon of the fool, air, from which he evolves. The serpents that entwine the caduceus are crowned, the left with the throne crown of Isis representing Bina, understanding, and the standard crown on the right representing Kether, the crown. Mercury is always in motion, and here the magician juggles 8 implements, for 8 is the number of his Sephira Hod. In the air surrounding him revolve his tools and elemental weapons of power. Dagger, air and the power to know. Cup, water, to dare. Winged egg, spirit, to go. Scroll that bears the word. Stylus that writes the word. Phoenix wand, tool of resurrection. Censer, fire, to will. Pentacle, earth, to keep silent. Related cards. The magician, Arcanum of Mercury, is the first of 7 planetary majors. The 2 Mercury-ruled zodiacal majors are the Lovers, Gemini, and the Hermit, Virgo. In The Lovers, the children of the voice, or divine, we see the magician's skill with the spoken word and ability to unlock choices. In The Hermit, also called the Magus of the Voice of Light, he decodes the written word, performs verbal magic, and acts as psychopomp. Mercury also rules 5 of the 36 decans. As 5 of Pentacles, or Lord of Worry, Taurus 1, he rules the anticipation and surmounting of obstacles. As 3 of Cups, or Lord of Abundance, Cancer 2, he rules ease of communication. As 10 of Pentacles, or Lord of Wealth, Virgo 3, he is dignified and exalted, and rules mercantile skill and communication with the dead. As 8 of Wands, or Lord of Swiftness, Sagittarius 1, he is in detriment, yet rules swift, smooth travel and flashes of insight. As 6 of Swords, or Lord of Science, Aquarius 2, he rules resourceful problem solving. In the 8, 9, and 10 of Swords, all Gemini cards, he expresses the mind's curiosity and computational ability, its power to freely make choices and comprehend their consequences. In the 8, 9, and 10 of Pentacles, all Virgo cards, he refines medicines for body and soul and material products to sustain the next generation. He oversees passage between the realms. 1 is the number generally ascribed to the Magus. The sun also enumerates to 1. 19 is 1 plus 9 equals 10, then 1 plus 0 equals 1. So does the Wheel of Fortune. 10 is 1 plus 0 equals 1. The close ties between these three cards speak to questions of individualism and destiny. Advanced concepts for further exploration. The relationship between the magician and the fool as progenitor. The powers of speech and silence as magic, and the tools of the magician's control over the elements and powers to create, wand, preserve, cup, destroy, sword, and redeem, pentacle, as described in Crowley's Liber B. Vel Magi sub Figura 1, which describes the highest possible manifestation in the physical plane, the grade of Magus. The tools of the magician as the ability to manipulate all four elemental powers of the Sphinx, to will, wand, to dare, cup, to know, sword, and to keep silent, pentacle. The similarities and differences between alchemical Mercury, universal Mercury, philosophical Mercury, and planetary Mercury. The emerald tablet of Hermes Trismegistus and the concept of transmutation. Magical weapon, the wand or caduceus. Magical power, miracles of healing, gift of tongues, knowledge of sciences. The High Priestess, the Priestess of the Silver Star. Card number 2. Planet and dignitaries, Moon, rules Cancer, exalted Taurus. Day of the week, Monday. Hebrew letter, Gimel. Hebrew letter meaning, double letter, camel, peace and war. Value 3. Path 13, Keter, crown or primum mobile, to Tiberet, 6, beauty or sun. Color scales in the four worlds, blue, silver, cold pale blue, silver, rayed sky blue. Themes and keywords, holy secrets, hidden mysteries, divinity, purity, virginity, autonomy, aspiration, vibration, astral light, wisdom, enchantment, divination, silence, esotericism, intuition, the anima, Holy Spirit, unvoiced belief, the cup. Astrology and element. The priestess is the planetary trump of our glamorous satellite, the moon, glowing with reflected light like a silver mirror. The moon's orbit around Earth is 28 and a half days. A day on the moon is the same, since it is tidally locked, forever facing Earth. Ever-changing, it shifts through its four main phases of light and darkness, new, waxing, full, and waning. As it changes, humans vibrate and flow with its tides. The moon affects the tides and the tides within, whether physical, mental, or emotional. Its orbit is the length of the menstrual cycle. It governs all things female. It affects sleep cycles in all the waters on Earth, including those within us. In astrology, the moon is as important as the sun, indicating our emotional capacity, feelings, home life, and bodily functions. It shows our magnetism and appeal to the public. It represents the human soul, our memories, the anima, our nurturing parent, and the many faces of our personality. It's our positive psychism, our intuition, and all that is receptive in human nature. It's our reflective inner light and our subconscious and unconscious feelings and needs. The glyph of the moon is a crescent, showing the reflected light of the sun. Turn it on its side and it looks like the bowl of a cup. This is the cup of the priestess. The crescent shape, when it appears in any of the planetary glyphs, represents the cup lofted, the uplifted personality and spiritual aspiration. The moon has rulership in Cancer and exaltation in Taurus. Mythology and alchemy. The priestess bears resemblance to the Hellenistic idea of Sophia as the initiatrix and personification of holy wisdom. The priestess of the Silver Star is also well represented by Artemis, Diana, whose epithet is Maiden of the Silver Bow. Artemis, with her arrows of silver, is the twin of Apollo with his arrows of gold. Artemis was a maiden goddess of the hunt who guarded her chastity fiercely. Her virtue shouldn't be thought of as asexuality. It signifies her completeness unto herself. Her power is in her autonomy and mastery of self. In spite of her virginity, she was known to help women with childbirth. Her iconography includes the bow and arrow, hunting dogs, and the moon. Hecate, whose name may be derived from a Greek word meaning she who works her will, or from one meaning the far-reaching one, is a goddess of magic and sorcery, light, herb lore, witchcraft, necromancy, and the crossroads. Also a virgin goddess, her appearance is often depicted as three-faced, suggesting the new full and half moon. The Egyptian Hathor, with her horned headdress, calls to mind the crescent moon. Isis, sky goddess of magic and wisdom, like the priestess of the Silver Star, has connections to the cosmos, especially to the star Sirius, the Silver Star. Isis is often depicted as veiled, a personification and allegory of the inscrutability of nature and her secrets. Her temple at Sais was said to bear the inscription, "I am all that has been and is and shall be, and no mortal has ever lifted my mantle." Qabalah, Path 13. The High Priestess's path is the longest on the tree, the first on the middle pillar, and the last to exit Keter. It crosses Da'at, the abyss below the supernal Sephirot, and terminates in Tipperet. This crucial path connects the Divine Father, Keter, and Son, Tipperet, the Yod and Vav of the Tetragrammaton, the greater and lesser countenance, the archetypal world of Atzilut, and the creative world of Bria, the mind and heart, the primum mobile, and the sun. Thus, the priestess connects our sacred origin to our literal source of life. The nature of that connection is known but hidden, inexpressible, esoteric, a mystery hidden in the abyss. The priestess may correspond to the Shekinah, the female form of God, who dwells here on earth, striving for reunion with her celestial counterpart. Her path corresponds to letter Gimel, meaning camel. The camel is the ship of the desert, conveying the traveler across long, inhospitable distances. It bears the spirit across Da'at, knowledge, the abyss which destroys the human ego. The camel's unseen reservoir makes survival possible. That reservoir is divine grace, the unknowable intention behind existence. Although we may not be able to express it in words, spiritual belief gives us the sense of meaning we require to live. It is the light that conceals by its brilliance. Thus, we see references to the entire tree of life in both priestess versions. Both emphasize the next step on the middle pillar, Yesod, the Sephira of the moon, where the magic of creation gathers before its final expression in Malkut. As a double letter, Gimel's attributes are wisdom and folly, for knowledge the rational mind can't express may indeed appear as madness. Rider-Waite-Smith symbolism. The queen of the borrowed light abounds with Tree of Life references, the 10 pomegranates depicted and partly obscured on the veil, the crown, Keter, the cross, Tiferet, associated with solar deities and the sun, the moon, Yesod, the gray pillar of force, and the black pillar of form. Her hidden Torah scroll peeks out from the position of Hod or Mercury. Yet each of these symbols holds other meanings as well. The crown might be a triple lunar crown evoking Hecate, the maiden mother crone. It might symbolize the sun and moon conjoined, or the solar disk or cowhorn's crown of Hathor. The pomegranates suggest the myth of Persephone and Demeter, reminding us that the high priestess is a sacred intermediary between realms separated by the veil. The veil itself may separate the unconscious and conscious minds, the living from the dead, the supernal realm from the mundane. The letters B and J refer to Boaz, in his strength, and Hakim, he establishes, the pillars of Solomon's temple, though they were thought to be made of brass. Their dynamic polar form contrasts with the flat gray of the Hierophant's pillars, direct versus apostolic transmission. The priestess's blue robes also evoke the Stella Maris, the Virgin Mary as star of the sea. As her robe dissolves into water, so water takes on form while remaining itself, a concept which correlates with virginity or purity. Taken together, this constellation of lunar symbols conveys secrecy, divine knowledge, faith, divination, and implicit communication between the seen and unseen parts of a whole. Thoth symbolism. Astral warps and wefts swirl, shimmer, and vibrate, veiling her in bluish light and turning the body of the enthroned priestess into a radiant cup. Lit by the white brilliance of Keter, the luminous veil conceals by its very brilliance. It separates the conscious from the unconscious, the known from the secret. Crowley calls this veil of light the menstruum of manifestation, and the possibility of form that arises from the third veil of the original nothing behind her. Beneath her, nascent forms are being created in the whorls of nature's seed pods, flowers, and crystals. As the embodiment of the middle pillar, she sits between silver pillars rayed sky blue. Her headdress of disc and crescent and her throne are emblems of Isis. 7 more crescents radiate beneath it, the 7th invoking Venus, whose path crosses hers horizontally, for she is both virgin and eternal mother. It brings the crescents on her crown to 8, the full division of phases of the moon. On her lap rests a bow that is also the lyre of Artemis. Its 3 strings recall the threefold goddess and the great mother Bina. The arrow across it, as well as the rainbow light within the cup, connects her to the temperance and art card, the continuation beyond her path that leads down to the lunar sephira of Yesod. Beneath her feet is an inverted crescent. This brings the total crescents in the images to 9, a lunar number. It also mirrors the inverted crescent that shines down upon the moon card. Yet she is firmly above it, signifying her mastery of the unconscious realms. At the bottom of the card is the camel of Gimel, showing her nature as a vehicle across the abyss, the place of esoteric knowledge. Related cards. The Priestess card, alone among trumps, has had the same astrological correspondence, the moon, across all tarot traditions since esoteric tarot's beginnings in the 18th century. The moon rules only one sign, Cancer, corresponding to the Chariot. She is exalted in Taurus and the Hierophant. The Chariot represents the moon's swift orbital speed and heavenly passage, its emotional fluidity, its protective, covert nature, and its role as bearer of news. The moon rules 5 of the 36 decans. As Six of Pentacles, or Lord of Success, Taurus 2, she is exalted and watches over the increase of fortunes and opportunity. As Four of Cups, or Lord of Luxury, Cancer 3, she rules the home, tides, and the forming and breaking of habits. As Two of Swords, or Lord of Peace, Libra 1, she rules non-ordinary states of consciousness, crossroads, and insights. As Nine of Wands, or Lord of Strength, Sagittarius 2, she rules natural cycles and memory. As Seven of Swords, or Lord of Futility, Aquarius 3, she rules illusions, travel, and reckless acts. In the 2, 3, and 4 of Cups, all Cancer cards, the Priestess expresses the hidden bonds of affection between individuals and the mysteries of maternity and sisterhood. The Priestess corresponds to the number 2, Lust, in the Thoth deck, and Justice, in the Waite deck, also enumerate to 2. 11 is 1 plus 1 equals 2, as does the Judgment or Aeon card. 20 is 2 plus 0 equals 2. All portray varying relationships to the other. Finally, the Priestess connects with the two other cards of the middle path, Temperance or Art, and the Universe or World. Advanced concepts for further exploration. The middle pillar ritual, an exercise for moving currents of energy through the chakras or psychic centers of the body through a visualization of ascending and descending light. The relationship between the Priestess, the other middle pillar paths, and the paths that form the bow of Kof Shin Tav. The rending of the veil ritual of ceremonial magic, which lifts the magician to a higher state of consciousness. The evolution of the Priestess to Empress as she crosses the Empress's path between the supernals. The seven hermetic principles or truths: mentalism, correspondence, vibration, polarity, rhythm, cause and effect, and gender. Magical weapon, bow and arrow. Magical power, the white tincture. Clairvoyance, divination by dreams. The Empress, the daughter of the mighty ones. Card number 3, planet and dignitaries, Venus, rules Taurus and Libra, exalted Pisces, day of the week, Friday. Hebrew letter, Dalet. Hebrew letter meaning, double letter, door, wisdom or folly. Value 4. Path 14, Chokmah. 2, wisdom or zodiac. 2, Bina. 3, understanding or Saturn. Color scales in the four worlds: emerald green, sky blue, spring green, bright rose, rayed pale green. Themes and keywords: fertility, creativity, maternity, love, sensuality, beauty and attraction, wife or mother, receptiveness, the womb, life and death, fructification, love and war goddesses, also the goddess, mother nature. Astrology or element. Other than the sun and moon, Venus is the brightest object in our sky. Trailing the sunset, she is the evening star, Hesperus. Preceding sunrise, the morning star, Lucifer. Like Inanna of the Seven Veils, she reveals herself to us in phases. The planet is mysteriously veiled by clouds and incredibly hot. Venus signifies female attributes, beauty, and how we attract and go about getting what we desire. Her glyph suggests a figure with welcoming arms and is comprised of the circle of spirit over the cross of matter. It looks like the Egyptian Ankh, meaning life. Life emanates from nature. The appetite of life for procreation is born from humankind, the cross, seeking completion, the circle. The glyph is the only one which connects all the sephirot of the tree of life. The planet Venus symbolizes all we find worthy of desire, usually love and money. Venus loves luxury, pleasure, and relationships of all kinds. She rules two signs, airy Libra by day and earthy Taurus by night. Libra, the seventh sign, represents beauty, harmony, balance, and marriage. Taurus, the second sign, is concerned with the comforts, pleasures, and necessities of life. As the lesser benefic, Venus bestows gifts. Her earthy presents are sensuality, refined taste, and resources, favors that grant prosperity. Her airy presents deal with charm, culture, physical symmetry and beauty, diplomacy, discernment, and popularity. In her fullness, she represents all that is creative, whether that involves nurturing children, making music, or the creative arts. Her exaltation in Pisces shows that it is through compassion that she best expresses her ideal of love as sacrifice. Mythology and alchemy. The Empress is the representation of alchemical salt. In alchemy, salt is the body and base matter. It is what remains after the process of combustion, the substance that survives death and generates new life. Salt is an enigma. It both preserves and corrodes, just as Venus is described by the alchemists as external splendor and internal corruption. Salt dries things out, yet is harvested from the waters of the sea. Heavenly Aphrodite, born from sea foam, is the amorous one, mother of passion and peace, and the giver of life. Portrayed as an infinitely desirable woman, her domain is that of love, pleasure, and procreation. We must never forget, though, that her favorite lover was Ares, god of war, and that her predecessor, Astarte, was both a fertility and a war goddess. Like the priestess, the empress is associated with Hathor. She is also associated with Isis in her role as queen of heaven, wife of Osiris, and mother of Horus. Yet Crowley reminds us, not only Isis, but Nephthys. Nephthys was the sister of Isis, nursemaid of Horus, and bride of warlike Set. She was called Lady of the Enclosure, representing the gateway, much like the Empress is often referred to as the Gate of Heaven. Where Isis guides the passage of birth, Nephthys guides passage through the Gate of Death, for one is inherent in the other. Demeter, Ceres, called She of the Grain, is a goddess of agriculture and maternal relationships. The name Ceres comes from roots meaning to feed and to grow. The suffix meter in the name Demeter refers to the word mother. The prefix D is an old name for a Thonic earth goddess. Thus, she is the Mother Earth. Her most famous tale involves her mourning the abduction of her daughter Persephone, causing the earth to wither in winter. Don't mess with Mother Nature. Qabalah, Path 14. The path of the Empress runs between Chokmah on the Pillar of Force and Bina on the Pillar of Form. The first of three horizontal paths, it runs above the abyss of Da'at and emphasizes the relationship between the three supernals. If Keter is the dimensionless point, Chokmah is a line and Bina a plane. If Keter is consciousness erupting and Chokmah the spark of vision, Bina is the spark received and understood. If Keter is the self and Chokmah the other, Bina is the desire to connect the two. Lights, camera, action. The Empress corresponds to Hebrew letter Dalet, meaning door. As the universal mother, she is the portal through which everything is born. In the concentric model of the universe embraced by classical esotericists, the realm of the stars exists outside the orbit of the outermost sphere, Saturn. In Qabalah, Chokhmah corresponds to the zodiac and Bina to slow, heavy Saturn, who is both Father Time and Eternal Mother. Thus, the Empress connects the celestial clockwork to our earthly concept of time. She connects the archetypal life force to our natural cycles and seasons. The opposing attributes of double-letter Dalit are peace and war, reminding us that goddesses of creation are also goddesses of destruction. Shakti, the feminine energy of the cosmos, releases even as it gives form. The door leads to darkness in one direction and light in the other. One cannot enter one room without exiting another. Rider-Waite-Smith symbolism. Whilst some planetary correspondences are subtle in this deck, the Empress's could not be more obvious. An unambiguous glyph of Venus, colored in with Venus's green hue on the heart-shaped stone by her throne. The stone itself recalls older tarot imagery, where the emperor and empress were worldly rulers with heraldic shields. But this empress is the maternal queen of love and life herself, Venus as creatrix rather than consort. Her enthroned figure is curved, possibly pregnant. Her setting is lush, a stark contrast to the emperor's dry mountains. The globe on her scepter is the world itself. Ripe wheat stalks suggest the Eleusinian mysteries of Demeter, which promised its initiates eternal renewal, as do the pomegranates on her dress, which mingle red and white, passion and purity. By a waterfall, deciduous and evergreen trees rise, possibly arborvitae or cypresses for Aphrodite's home isle of Cyprus. The goddess is both eternal and cyclical. Perhaps the water source is Eden itself. The Empress's pearls recall the birth of Venus from seafoam off the shore of Paphos in Cyprus. Her diadem of 12 stars refers to the 12 months or zodiacal signs, but it also marks her as the woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. Almost a composite of the priestess and empress, and the Thoth lust figures, and certainly a way of invoking the sacred feminine. Hewn stone, textiles, and natural forms combine, reminding us that humanity's arts are her children too. Thoth symbolism. The figure in the Thoth card represents the universal woman as the many-throned, many-minded, many-wild daughter of Zeus. The arch above her refers to her letter Dalit, meaning door, and her role as the gate of heaven. Her esoteric title, Daughter of the Mighty Ones, may refer to the supernal parents she connects. She sits between crescents that could be the phases of Venus or the moon. She faces the one waxing, northern hemisphere, which signifies growth and increase. Her posture creates the glyph of salt, suggesting amniotic fluid, and she holds her left arm in the gesture known as Mater Triumphans, Isis holding the infant Horus. In her right hand is the wand of Isis, whose lotus is a metaphor for the grail, as it sits in water, yet opens to the sun. Clothed in emerald green and rose, she sits among twisting blue shapes, symbolic of her birth from water. The dove and sparrow, birds of Aphrodite, correspond to love and promiscuity. Her tunic is embroidered with bees, industrious female workers and honey gatherers. Dominoes on her sleeves symbolize her domestic nature and are surrounded by the spirals of natural growth. She wears the girdle of Venus inscribed with the 12 zodiacal signs. The tapestry beneath her is embroidered with royal fleur-de-lis and fishes. Crowley says they are adorning the secret rose at the base of her throne. Her shield bears the white eagle, a symbol of passive femininity, salt, matter awaiting activation by sulfur. At her side, a pelican feeds her young with the blood of her breast. The Great Mother gives an inheritance and sacrifice of blood that raises the daughter to her throne. Related cards. The Empress corresponds to Venus, presiding over the Hierophant, Taurus, and Justice or Adjustment, Libra. These bookend the growing season in the Northern Hemisphere. The Empress presides over both spring fertility and fall harvest. In the Hierophant, we see her consecrating the union of male and female, earthly and divine, in the service of procreation. In the Justice and Adjustment card, we see her as the great equilibrator, balancing beginnings and endings to maintain the Earth's rhythm, creating beauty and equal partnerships. Venus rules five minor arcana. As Four of Wands, or Lord of Completion, Aries III, she is in detriment, ruling celebrations, especially weddings and the arts of peace. As Two of Cups, or Lord of Love, Cancer I, she rules attraction, respect, affection, and new relationships. As Nine of Pentacles, or Lord of Gain, Virgo II, she rules adornment and gracious living, and, as she is in fall, is prone to perfectionism. As the Seven of Cups, or Lord of Debauch, Scorpio III, she confers magnetic, visionary artistry, but is prone to addiction and escapism as she is in detriment. As the Five of Swords, or Lord of Defeat, Aquarius I, she rules offbeat sensibilities. In all cases, she has the power to cast glamours of varying duration and efficacy. In the Five, Six, and Seven of Pentacles, all Taurus cards, she expresses the miraculous quickening of life and those forces which imperil it. In the Two, Three, and Four of Swords, all Libra cards, she weighs, judges, and balances the mind to create harmonious relationships. Three is the Empress's number. Also enumerating to three by reduction are the Hanged Man, 12 is 1 plus 2 equals 3, and the World or Universe, 21 is 2 plus 1 equals 3. Venus's exaltation is at 27 degrees Pisces, giving her a special connection with the Moon, Pisces, as well. Advanced concepts for further exploration. The Empress as the gate of heaven, or the portal of both birth and death, and her relationship as mother to the daughter of the World or Universe Maiden of Malkut, whose epithets also include various gates. Alchemical salts as the substance of the body, the receptive principle, and the process of dissolution, purification, and recrystallization. The alchemical concepts of the White Queen as the passive or fixed principle and the realm of feelings. The White Eagle as gluten and vessel of first matter, the lunar white work of purification of the subconscious, and the clarifying process of albedo. The relationship between the Empress and the other horizontal paths on the Tree of Life. Magical weapon, the girdle. Magical power, love filters. The Emperor, Son of the Morning, Chief among the Mighty. Card number 4. Sign and dignitaries, Aries, cardinal fire. Ruler, Mars, sun exalted. Motto, I am. Hebrew letter, He, Rider-Waite-Smith, Tzadi, Thoth. Hebrew letter meaning, simple letter, He, window or sight. Value 5. Simple letter, Tzadi, fish hook or imagination. Value 90. Path 15, Rider-Waite-Smith, Chokmah, 2, wisdom or zodiac, 2, Tiperet, 6, beauty or sun. Path 28, Thoth, Netzach, 7, victory or Venus, 2, Yesod, 9, foundation, moon. Color scales in the four worlds, scarlet, red, brilliant flame, glowing red. Themes and keywords, dominion, rulership or kingship, structure, government, paternity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.